The right tool can mean the difference between a fun, quick, high-quality project and a frustrating hack job you end up doing over again. And while you might not realize it at first, creating a smooth and enjoyable workflow for your 3D printed projects requires a lot more little tools and accessories than you get in the box. Stick around, because in this video, I'm going to share all of them with you, as well as what they're used for, where you can get them, and much, much more. Let's start the list off with one that you probably haven't thought of, and one that I know I'm going to get flamed for. Good God, these dad jokes are getting even worse with each video. Cigar lighters. My most surprising and often useful tool for my 3D printed workflow is, surprisingly, a cigar lighter. You know, one of those torch-style lighters that have a very focused, very hot flame? Now, this tool is one that I discovered kind of accidentally when I ran into trouble with various different prints, and I use it in a few different ways. First of all, it's great for gently softening prints in case you need to bend them, reshape them, or tweak them in some way. Sure, you can use a heat gun or a hairdryer for this, and we'll discuss those later, but a cigar lighter offers a much more focused heat source, even if you pull it away a few centimeters. This leads me to the second way I use it, which is saving curling prints. Sometimes, early on in a print, the corners may start to curl, and you just know that this means that either the whole side of the print will be compressed in the best case, or worst case, your nozzle will eventually get caught on the curled edge and lift up the entire part of that print, causing a failure. Fortunately, I discovered that I can actually use a cigar lighter's focused heat to soften this curly corner and then use a scraper or other tool to flatten it back down into position. Obviously, you need to be very careful here so as not to completely melt the heck out of the part, and you probably should pause the print before you do this. But this one trick alone has saved me countless, countless reprints. The third way I use this tool is one that you're not gonna like, because it's honestly really janky, but I often use a cigar lighter to melt, weld, or modify prints. Sometimes, if I just don't care about the aesthetics of a part, I'll melt away parts that didn't turn out the way I wanted them to. Other times, if I have a large surface area to work with, I'll completely melt the two parts in the middle and glue them together with molten material instead of glue. Is it perfect? No. Is it janky? Sure. But as the saying goes, it's not stupid if it works. Okay, this one is going to seem really silly. I mean, seriously, Jonathan, a rag? But here's the thing. Pretty early on, I discovered that not all towels are created equal, and that paper towels are just not viable or environmentally friendly. Sure, you could use wet wipes, but, well, some of us actually care about the planet. In any case, I went through a process of testing out different towels and rags, and I actually discovered that most types leave a ton of little fibers on your build surface, which will either lead to bad bed adhesion or wind up embedded in the first layer of your print. To avoid ugly and problematic first layers, switch to one of those microfiber cleaning cloths, which leave far fewer fibers. Up next, let's talk about alcohol. Personally, I don't drink it, but I do clean my bed with it, and so should you. However, one thing that I discovered is that most of the alcohol you buy in the pharmacy is, in fact, only 70% isopropanol. I'm no mathematician, but back when I was in school, 99% was higher than 70%. And that's why industrial and cosmetic supply stores each carry 99% isopropyl alcohol. Sure, you can clean your bed with 70% alcohol, but you're just going to get more of the gunk off, get a better first layer, and deal with far fewer adhesion issues overall if you just use the highest quality alcohol. Plus, if you ever want to experiment with PVA filament, which can be smoothed using alcohol and not harsh fumes like acetone, then you are 100% going to need the 99% stuff to get good results. Ask me how I know. 99% isopropanol will get you very far, but eventually the day will come where your prints will still stop sticking to the print surface. I don't know why this happens, nobody does, but it happens. When that day comes, don't turn to me and shake your bottle of 99% alcohol in the air, just get some good dish soap. Now, what exactly do I mean by good dish soap? After all, I, like you, once believed that all dish soap was pretty much created equal, and I went about cleaning my build plate with some lame old store brand stuff that was on sale, only to discover that literally nothing would stick to either of my build plates after that. It was as if my build plate had spontaneously turned into the greased up deaf guy from Family Guy. Fortunately, after my mother-in-law jokingly told me that the stuff I was using wasn't even good enough to clean her floors, I realized the error of my ways. I ran out and I bought the local equivalent of Dawn name brand dish soap, and the difference was night and day, you guys. Night and day. Suddenly, my build surface was stickier than that new BTS K-pop song you don't want to admit you love. The lesson was clear. Get some good dish soap. Enough said. All right, now that you have the means to keep your bed clean, let's make a god-awful sticky mess of it, shall we? Yes, with proper cleaning techniques, you will be able to print most materials on your print surface, whatever that is, most of the time. But sometimes that just won't be enough, either because you're too lazy to go to the kitchen and clean your print surface with a sponge, me, or because you're working with trickier materials for your particular bed surface. I, for example, have a really hard time getting ASA to stick to any of my print surfaces, and I've heard that polycarbonate and nylon are a nightmare to work with as well. Now, I've never printed with either of those materials personally, but I would be interested to hear in the comments below. Would you want me to do a video where I try and experiment with these materials and share my experience as a first timer on how easy or hard they are to work with? Let me know in the comments below if you want me to do that video. Anyways, when you inevitably encounter situations where you need a little more adhesion, glue stick is your friend. And any old glue stick will work in my experience, but some of them, like this clear stuff I picked up at the dollar store here, can actually be too strong. And paradoxically, this is a problem because glue stick is also used to decrease bed adhesion, for example, if you're printing PETG with a PEI bed. You see, it does this by creating a thin interface layer between the print surface and the print itself, which ideally will protect the bed from being torn up by these extra sticky materials. One of the things you learn as you become more and more familiar and advanced with 3D printing is that certain types of filament are hygroscopic, or in other words, they suck up moisture from the air. When that happens, the filament prints poorly, as you've seen in some of my past videos, and loses its mechanical properties. The only way to fix this is to stick it in the oven for half a day or use a pricey filament dryer to remove the moisture. But you can avoid all that mess with these next few tools. First, get a few cheap hygrometers, ideally with temperature sensors right in there, and stick them anywhere you're going to be storing your filament, so you'll know exactly if and when your environmental conditions change such that you need to be worried about humidity. Then, for preserving your more hygroscopic filaments, I recommend that you check out a good set of vacuum bags and an electric vacuum. Personally, I've gone through dozens and dozens of those cheapy ones that you see on AliExpress, but honestly, they get punctured if you so much as look at them the wrong way, so I've recently upgraded my vacuum bag collection to much sturdier ones. Now, I really like the ones provided by Ataraxia, which store two rolls at a time, as well as these newer high-quality ones from iBose 3D that were recommended by Courtney over at Filament Stories. Just make sure that if you are going to invest in some vacuum bags, you probably want to get an electric pump. It can be really annoying and time-consuming to pump those bags manually. Now, once you have your vacuum bags, you'll also definitely want to pick up some reusable silica gel packets to put inside and suck out any remaining moisture from the bag. Now, I know, your filament already comes with silica gel, but you have no way of knowing whether or not it's saturated. With these color-changing, interchangeable, rechargeable packets, you can tell just by looking at them if they are saturated and ineffective or not. And I have to be honest, I discovered pretty quickly after buying them that I need to be much, much more strict about how I store and use silica gel and hygroscopic filaments as a whole, because they turned pink pretty quickly in the Tel Avivian humidity. Now, by the way, the last note on vacuum bags, you can get one of those cheapy hand pumps, but frankly, it's gonna make you a lot less likely to actually do the work and vacuum your filament bags. It lasted about a week because I was way too lazy and excited to get to the next print and I wouldn't actually vacuum. Instead, what I use now is this cheapy vacuum bag sealer tool. Really, really cheap on AliExpress. You push a button and you put it up against the bag and it will vacuum out all the air. It will even mount onto the vacuum bag so you can proceed with your filament change while it's doing all the boring work. By the way, while we're talking about filament, I want to take a moment to thank today's sponsor, Voxel PLA. Now, I don't know about you, but I go through a lot of filament, especially PLA, and so I'm always looking for great deals when it comes to filament. And though I've had some major misses in the past buying cheap filament, leading to almost entire rolls being wasted, I've recently discovered Voxel PLA. Now, Voxel PLA is super high quality filament produced under rigorous manufacturing conditions and tested for tensile strength, melt flow index, and much, much more. They even use it in their own 150 machine print farm to ensure the utmost reliability. And yet, despite all of this, Voxel PLA sells for just $16.99 a kilo, and they actually offer free shipping on 2+ spools in the USA. Voxel is used and trusted by many of the other content creators that I look up to and follow, so I personally have a huge shipment of their stuff coming to me in the next week or two. To check out Voxel PLA and order some for yourself, visit the link in the description or go to voxelpla.com. All right, let's switch gears and talk about a little bit of a more common one, but one that I was surprised that many of you didn't know about, a deburring tool. Now, I'm not really sure what the heck a burr is, but I know that we probably don't want them. Enter the deburring tool. It's great for scraping off strings, boogers, remnants of supports, and other nuisances from your 3D prints. It's also really great at removing brims without a trace if you're the kind of person who uses them. After all, you really don't need the neighbors finding out what you do in your private time. Another cool thing about the deburring tool is that it has a rounded edge, so you won't hack off a finger like you would with an X-Acto knife. Now, this is actually something that you can print yourself at home, as I mentioned in my 3D printed videos tool. And then you just need to buy the replacement blades on AliExpress, links in the description below. Though, if you want something with a nice hefty feel, there are stainless steel ones on Amazon that you can check out. Now, these are another one that might seem obvious, but nobody seems to talk about them at all. You probably already have a set of pliers, maybe even one that came with your 3D printer. But if you don't, then you really should get some. These are used for removing supports, as well as changing nozzles and all sorts of little odd jobs in and around your 3D printer. Here's another obvious one, or at least one that I thought was obvious, but definitely one that you need. Flat cutters are a special type of cutting tool which will cut all the way at the edge of a tool, meaning that you can cut a flat bit out of a protrusion. That's really confusing, but basically this makes them great for removing parts of supports that just don't want to come off or digging into hard to reach places to remove odd bits of plastic. They're also really convenient for cutting your filament at a specific angle before inserting it into your extruder. And of course, links in the description below. Make sure that you get the dark blue handle one. All right, let's change gears and talk about some tools for working on your 3D printer itself. I know what you're already thinking. You have some Allen keys already that came with your 3D printer and about 100 other ones that you've collected from various pieces of IKEA furniture over the years. But here's the thing. On your 3D printer, there are a lot of tight, hard to reach spaces. And in those instances, you're going to want a set of Allen keys with this special ball head, which will catch the bolts at a variety of different angles instead of being restricted to just working head on. They are also ideally going to be of much higher quality because let's face it, the freebie ones that you may currently be using are pretty likely to lose their sharp corners with extended use. One of the things nobody tells you about 3D printing is that you're going to be spending a lot of time tweaking and repairing your machines. So if you don't have an awesome set, I highly recommend picking one up. Next on my list of tools is this fancy low-profile thin wrench that I picked up on AliExpress. Now, while the socket holder print I shared previously is a really good one, this one actually goes a step further by basically fitting in under your nozzle when it's only a couple of millimeters off the build surface. It's also conveniently set up in a cone shape so that you just need to pull it back and it will get stuck at the right size for that particular nozzle or bolt. Now, if you, like me, have multiple printers with many different nozzle and bolt sizes, well, this is just really convenient. At just a few bucks, this is definitely worth picking up as it'll make changing nozzles so much easier. I'm still waiting for E3D to reach out about that Revo system. A guy can dream, right? All right, here's one that definitely isn't absolutely necessary, but it has definitely saved me some major hassles and saved a few prints from having to be completely redone. A low-cost 3D pen. See, basically a 3D pen is just an extruder strapped on with a hot end that you can hold in your hand, and therefore you can extrude filament wherever you might need it. Now, I don't use this for actually making 3D drawings or anything like that. I use it for fixing 3D prints that don't come out exactly perfectly, have holes, or something like that. Now, to be clear, they will look pretty hideous because the 3D pen is a very, very crude and imprecise instrument. But if the area of the part that you need to fix is hidden away or it's a functional part that you just don't care about it looking pretty, the 3D pen can save you from having to reprint it entirely. All right, gang. I hate to do this, but some of my recent videos with 28 to 50 different prints and examples have taken really, really long times both to shoot and to edit, and the YouTube algorithm is already penalizing me for not releasing videos frequently enough. Plus, I know you are all busy and probably should be doing something else besides watching me geek out on YouTube. So instead of putting my full list of tools into one 30 to 45 minute long video, I'm actually going to break this one up into two videos with the next one coming out next week. Now, please make sure to subscribe and hit the bell notification icon so that you won't miss out when that video comes out. And also, I'd just love to know in the comments below if you prefer these longer videos less frequently or if you want shorter videos every single week. I do read every single comment and I take your feedback very, very seriously. So seriously, in fact, that I already ordered a new $2,000 camera to fix the autofocus issues some of you pointed out and all new lights to improve that. So yeah, make sure to like and subscribe because it really helps. And if you found this video helpful, feel free to click that thanks button and let me know. Thank you, as always, for watching this video, and tune in next week for the rest of my list because there are definitely some good ones that I saved for it. Take care and happy 3D printing.